In this series of figures, let's examine the effects of blood volume and central venous pressure on cardiac output and blood pressure. Let's start in the center here with a broad overview. Let's start with Poiseuille's law, which states that Q, or flow, equals the pressure gradient along that pipe, along that blood vessel, delta P, divided by the resistance to flow along that vascular circuit. Now, if we substitute the terms for the entire systemic circuit, what we would get is Q is cardiac output for the entire system. That's going to equal delta P, the pressure gradient for that entire circuit, which would be our blood pressure, the difference between aortic pressure and the large vein pressure, which is near zero. And so really, it's aortic pressure. And that's going to be divided by not the resistance of one vessel, but the resistance of all of the vessels in that circuit. That's referred to as total peripheral resistance. Now, if we rearrange this to solve for blood pressure, we get blood pressure equals cardiac output times total peripheral resistance. So we already have two of the main factors affecting blood pressure here. Total peripheral resistance, largely determined by the constriction or dilation of the muscular arteries and the arterioles through the action of the sympathetic nervous system or hormones. And cardiac output is determined by the product of heart rate and stroke volume. And so heart rate is determined largely by changes to output of the SA node, the rate at which that pacemaker cells fire. Again, determined by neural output, sympathetic and parasympathetic, on those cells. Stroke volume can also be affected by hormones and neurotransmitters, but one of the main factors affecting stroke volume is actually the venous return, what our end diastolic volume is. And so our end diastolic volume is a major determining factor of our stroke volume. Well, what determines our end diastolic volume? Well, that's determined by our venous return. Well, what determines our venous return? Well, that's determined largely by our central venous pressure. What determines central venous pressure? That's largely determined by our blood volume. Ah, there we go. Our major factors here, all the way back to the beginning. So if we have an increase, let's just go one direction here for a moment. If we have an increase in blood volume, a large portion of that volume will end up in the high compliance veins. That's going to increase our central venous pressure there. That's going to be the pressure that drives us to fill the heart with blood in its diastolic phase, central venous pressure here. And so if central venous pressure goes up, our venous return goes up. If our venous return goes up, we fill more during diastole and our end diastolic volume goes up. If our end diastolic volume goes up, our stroke volume goes up. That's known as the Frank-Starling mechanism. Frank-Starling mechanism is really a length-tension relationship for cardiac muscle. The more we stretch cardiac muscle, the greater degree of overlap of thick and thin filaments and within our sarcomeres, and the harder contraction we get, increasing our cardiac output. Now, on the left here, let's start with a system sort of at steady state. And in that system, we have the right side of our heart here ejecting blood and driving it to the lungs for oxygenation. That blood's going to come back through the pulmonary veins to the left side of the heart. We're going to fill that left ventricle. We're going to pressurize it and drive our cardiac output. Now, note that at steady state, the amount of blood coming out of the heart, our cardiac output, is going to equal the amount of blood going through our systemic tissues, that's systemic flow, as well as being equal to the amount of blood coming back to the heart, our venous return. Now let's change something. Let's increase that blood volume, which again, as we said just moments ago, is going to increase our central venous pressure. That's what we're seeing happen right here. So as we said, that's going to increase our venous return. We're going to get that increase in distension of the right ventricle. A good example of when this might occur is during exercise. During exercise, we have what's called a muscular pump. Our skeletal muscles compress these veins and drive blood back to the heart. Again, it can also happen simply when we get an increase in blood volume through an IV, for example, or simply drinking a large volume of water, right? We're going to get an increase in blood volume. It's going to drive an increase in our EDV. That's going to cause this increased distension. And again, a Frank-Starling mechanism, which causes a harder contraction. Cardiac output goes up, blood flow through the lungs goes up, venous return from the lungs goes up back into the left side of our heart, increased distension over here. A similar Frank-Starling mechanism on the other side of the heart. Increased pressure generation, increased cardiac output. That, of course, is going to increase our blood pressure. Our increase in blood pressure, go back to Poiseuille's law, pressure, right here, drives our flow. And so we're going to get an increase in our systemic flow. Last thing to say is that it's important to keep that balance between right heart and left heart outputs. So the dueling Frank-Starling mechanisms on both sides is important so that blood does not back up into one circuit or the other, usually into the pulmonary circuit because it's low resistance, and that causes a multitude of problems.